gentlemen, so pardon me, I'm afraid.
That's all right.
At the same time,
there's just one little grievance we should like to rectify.
What?
Don't be alarmed, it's nothing serious. It is arranged that until it is decided which of us is to be the actual king, we are to reign as one person.
Exactly.
Now, although we reign as one person, we are in point of fact two
persons. I don't think we can go into that. It is a legal fiction, and legal fictions are solemn things.
Yes. Perhaps you cannot recognize two independent persons, but you must recognize two independent appetites. It's all very well to say we act as one person, but when you supply us with one ration between us, I should describe it as a legal fiction carried a little too far.
It's a rather nice point. I do like to express an opinion on that. I suppose we reserve it for arguing before the full court.
Yes, but what are we to do in the meantime?
We want our tea!
I think we may need an interim order for double rations on their Majesty's entering into the usual undertaking to indemnify in the event of an adverse decision.
That will need to meet the case. Just work hard, stick to it. Nothing like work.
Oh, sir. You quite understand the man who holds the magnificent position of king to do something to govern. We are called your match. We are allowed to tie ourselves magnificent clothes. Our subjects frequently run to us in the streets. The sentries always return our salutes, and we enjoy the inestimable privilege of heading up subscription lists to all the principal charities. In return for this, at least we can make ourselves useful without the palace. Dispatches and foreign politicians circumvent. Then, if business isn't heavy, we may hold the royal levy or ratify some acts of parliament. Then we probably recruit the House of Tips. Then the people shall us and shall boots. Then the seeming ceremonial and state. And interesting Eastern potentate. After that, we generally go and dress up by a family. It's a rather nervous empty piece of touch. And to find the points of letters into every form of finance. They shame you in silence, so we help them if we can. Then you are craving dinner, we go down for the dinner, and we polish your regalia or the coronation plate. Spend an hour in titillating all our gentlemen in waiting, or we run on little errands for the ministers of state. Oh, philosophers may see of the troubles of a king, but the duties are delightful and the privilege is great. But the privilege and pleasure that we treasure beyond measure is to run a little pen for the ministers of state. Make a proclamation or receive a deprecation, then we possibly create a peer or two. Then we help the fellow creature on his path. If the counter or the thistle or the bath, then we dress and toddle off in semi-state. To a festival, a function or a fete, then we go and stand a sentry at the palace dining. Then we dine and serve the coffee and then 12:30 for one. With a pleasure that's emphatically retired to a magic with a gratifying feeling that our duty has been done. Oh, philosophers may sing of the troubles of a king, but the pleasures that are men and the worries that are man. But the culminating pleasure that we treasure beyond measure is a gratifying feeling that our duty has been done.
Philosophers may sing of the troubles of the king, but the pleasures that are many and the
of their good nature.
How nice they were after double ration.
Most considerate. There's only one thing wanting to make us thoroughly comfortable.
And that is?
The dear little wives we left behind us 3 months ago. You're a dainty man to please.
This is indeed a most delightful surprise.
My guess, you see, it was like this. After his death, he got very dull and lonely, and the days just crawled by, and he never wrote. So at last I said to him that I can't stand this any longer. Those two poor monarchs haven't got anybody to mend their clothes, so why not on them, pinch their stockings? At least, I believe they haven't. So let us all go and pack the chains and see how they get them on. And then she sat down, and then they all sat down. Oh, and I asked old Jacopo to lend us his boat, and he sat down, and we crossed the sea, and thank goodness that's done. And here we are, and I'm done. And now, which should we be doing? Just to be queen.
That we shan't know until Nursia arrives. In the meantime, the question is, how shall we celebrate the commencement of our honeymoon? Gentlemen, will you allow us to offer you a magnificent banquet?
We will!
Thanks very much. And ladies, what do you say to a dance?
Because a Lord High Chancellor is a personage of great dignity who
should not, under any circumstances, place himself in the position of being told to tuck in his tuppenny, except by a nobleman of the same rank. A Lord High Archbishop, for example, might tell a Lord High Chancellor to tuck in his tuppenny, but certainly not a Coke gentleman, certainly not a Coke.
What about a Lord High Coke?
My good friend, that is not a rank which is recognized by the Lord Chamberlain's office. No, no, it won't do. I'll give you an instance in which the experiment was tried. There lived a king so fine and cold in the wonder working days of old, when hearts in sand were good as gold and 20 times as men know. But tempers fry and leaves his hand in his heart in wonder place, for all the early human race and every wretched fellow. When he had a Rhenish wine to drink, his maiden very sad to think that some had done before and didn't be content with body. Rich as me, and he was rich as rich can be. So to the top of every tree, promoted everybody. And bishops in their shovel hats were plentiful as tabby cats, in point of fact too many. Ambassadors brought up by name, my ministers and such as they do, like asparagus in mink and jewels were three a penny. On every side two marshal things for beer were lords and fenty. With admiral of the ocean, king of grand, his right dominions.
My dear child! chamber, waiting for me to interview her.
Bonner, thank you for going.
Put out of her suspense. She's quite all right. She has all the illustrated papers. Anyway, I'll go and interrogate her. And in the meantime, might I suggest the absolute propriety of your regarding yourselves as single young ladies? Good evening.
Well, here's a pleasant state of things.
Delightful. One of us is married to two young ladies, and no one knows which, and the other is married to one young lady whom no one can identify.
One of us is married to one of you. The other is married to nobody. But one of us is married to which of you and wants to become a mere other.
It's quite simple. Observe. Two husbands have managed to acquire three wives. Two husbands, three wives, that's two-thirds of a husband each wife.
Oh, Mount Vesuvius, here we are in arithmetic. My good sir, one can't marry a vulgar fraction.
You know I call me a vulgar fraction?
We're thinking about this. The situation is entangled. Let's try and comb it out.
I have to do it, I want children to attend to the family, the man of my heart. There are two of them.
Well, it is true that at present His Majesty is a double gentleman, but once the circumstances of his marriage have been ascertained, he will, ipso facto, boil down to a single gentleman, thus presenting a unique opportunity whereby a man becomes both single and married by the same operation.
I have no instances in which the characteristics of both conditions have existed concurrently in the same individual.
Oh, I think it's a bit of Marsatoro.
Well, whatever happens, I shall of course be a dutiful wife. But I can never love my husband.
Oh, my child, don't say that. It is surprising what unprepossessing people one can love if one puts one's mind to it.
I love your father.
Oh, my God. That remark is somewhat harsh, don't you think? A little uncalled for, perhaps? Somewhat cruel, I imagine to be.
My dear brother, I said to myself, that man is a duke, and I will
sweltering till here. Oh, I mean, who can look back on our 95 at home?
And all this, just as I am invoted at a premium.
Oh, bah!
Your Majesty is surely aware that directly your Majesty's father went before the Parliament, was applied for over and over again.
My dear, Her Majesty's father was applied for over and over again, and applied for most urgently too, long before he was registered under the Limited Liability Act. What? For her unhappy commoners and lads for their enjoyment, a cause of that of noble rank, congenial employment. Of our attempts, we offer you examples illustrating the one's light, and I might add, its most remunerating. To set it and second-rate out of the night.
Yes, all
in my day. From laying, I find many feeling it has a lot up to my making.
Your children is
made. A judge it is the best achievers.
I get 10% of the taking.
One cent for the takings. I present to you ladies one of the shameless smacking. Double propriety. When virtue and washer acts are quite washer than a lord to the first society.
Perfect society.
I've heard my neighbors.
On the direction of several companies,
one.
As soon as I float it, I'm cleaning my notes, I'm busy well paid for my trouble.
Yeah.
my daughter. And what do I find? And do I find, for instance, a guard of honor to meet us? No.
No.
The town will be illuminated. And more.
No.
Refreshment provided? Nay! A royal salute fired?
Yet.
Triumphant arches erected. The bells set ringing?
No.
I see. One. The visitors. And I rang it myself. But it will not do, gentlemen. It will not do.
Upon my honor, I am very sorry. But I was brought up in its own land, and my ideas of politeness is said to take him off my cap to customers when they did.
That's all very well in its way, but it is not enough.
I'll take off anything else in reason for
that. Royal salute for my daughter. It costs so little.
Oh, Papa, I don't want a salute.
My dear sir, as soon as we know who Plus is entitled to take that liberty, she shall have as many salutes as she likes.
As for triumphal arches and guards of honor, we don't know our people, they wouldn't stand for it.
They're very offhand.
You mustn't allow that. No, you must keep them in proper discipline. You must impress your court with your importance. You need a deportment, a carriage.
Oh, we've got carriage.
No, manners.
We've got carriage.
Dignity. There must be a good deal of this sort of thing. A little of this sort of thing. My dear sir, you'll find that we are living in a dump of the river this year.
Yes, perhaps you're passing by, drop in.
That may
very often. You really often don't know how we're situated. It's not fair to the general. Why? I'd rather not. You.
Well, I don't know how to explain. Madam. Hi. We. There's several of us.
Gentlemen, I am bound to listen to you. But it's right to tell you that, not knowing I was married in infancy, I am head and ears in love with somebody else.
Our case exactly. We all were head and ears in love with somebody else. In point of fact, we all lie.
Let him forthwith be crowned.